I begin by reading to you from a 1991 article which I wrote. The young woman sat in darkness, her body a crystal attached to a matrix of stone. In the womb of the cave, she was alone, yet voices ascended hidden stairways in her mind, whispering truth from beyond the tide. Long forgotten stars swirled in dreamlike weaves inside her eyes, revealing a single ray of light. This beam, a slender wand of pure substance, entered the crown of her head, sending its rarefied nutrients of knowledge through her cellular being. She had come to the window in the sky, and now she would pass through it. She would become a vessel for the Zumir. Her generations would know her as a grail of the star. In January 1991, I began receiving information, small doses at a time, concerning a light coding of women in the distant past with a genetic knowledge of origin and gathering. I came to realize that this coding factor was given forth from a superior intelligence deep within a star system. It came into Earth's field through a converging within the heavens of invisible stars, realms of star consciousness which have yet to become visible within our spectrum of light. I must pause in the reading here to say I now know, in 2024, that this would have been from the trapezium of Orion. I was told by my sources that this occurrence took place in very ancient times at certain points upon the Earth, the central place being Rapa Nui, or Easter Island, in the Pacific Ocean. Here the command function was imprinted, signaling outward to its primary stations, Ayers Rock in Australia and the Gate of the Sun at Lake Titicaca, Peru. There were also minor stations receptive to this sacred transmission around the planet. Young women of elect star genetics were selected to participate, to become what is translated as grails of the sun. This meant that their DNA and RNA would be imprinted with a code light of origin and gathering, which was an integration with their true spirit origins. This would be passed genetically down their lineage tree. It would include a knowledge of spiritual and physical gathering on the outer and or inner planes at certain times, in which these encoded offspring would come together to register a song or harmony of their mutual design. The song would in turn open the individual to his or her homing signal, his or her recall to homeward light. This term was familiar to me as my sources had often signed off through the years with the blessings of the homeward light. This was long before little E.T.'s call home was presented to the world. The orchestration on Earth of the code light was under the guardianship and authority of both the Hokomai, guardians of the dweller crystal skulls in the inner Earth, and the Noakane, guardians of the order of the labyrinth. Again, I wish to pause from the initial reading to read to you a synopsis of the Thothic translations on the Noakane. The Noakane are star-embodied entities working closely with the divine Aeneid to accelerate the lost Pyrrha codes towards LP40, which is the flashpoint of planetary ascension. They are known as the controllers or manifestors of the star fields, which are holographically reproduced within the subsystem of dweller crystal skulls known as the Lotus. The Noakane play a pivotal role in maintaining the station frequency tribe light, which upholds the force field for for these holographic projections within the frequency patterning of Earth. The Noachane are also part of the Hesperus, angelic or star beings who have become enmeshed with the human life wave through the ancestral lineage of Tubal-Cain and Noah. They are considered the innermost guardians and light bearers of the Order of the Labyrinth, having a significant role in the esoteric practices and protection of sacred knowledge. Now, I know that this is rather difficult to understand and follow again because there are so many references. And in this video, I can't possibly go off onto all these references and explain them. But I just wanted you to have a feeling of the gravitas of the Noachane. Those who came to initiate the inner scribing of the imprint were the Zumir within the Artipal family from Sirius. The Zumir are not fully lion-like as are the guardians of Tel Sakara, but do contain some feline features. Apparently, just as humans of Earth have their relations in the stars, so there are other genetic or paragenetic families. The lion-headed ones, guardians of the Tel Sakara capstone on the Universal Tear and the Eye of Ra, are also from Sirius. And of course, all of these are our star kindred. Some of the features of the Zumir can be seen in the giant stone faces of Easter Island, although this was after they mixed with the humans of Rapa Nui. These pieces were carved for the purpose of Orombalos. This is the infusion of stone with the properties of presence, whether it be animation or other magical attributes. The living giants of Rapa Nui were endowed by the Zumir with powers of animation, transformation, healing, projection, and protection. They were the watchers of the sacred isle, where within the caverns was the Huris, the transmitting crystal that grounded and recalibrated the code light. In seeking to learn more about Rapa Nui's past, I was guided to a library book entitled Mysteries of Easter Island by Francis Mazier. I hope I'm pronouncing the gentleman's last name correctly. This little book chronicled Mr. Mazier's journey to Rapa Nui in the early 60s. I browsed through numerous other books on the island, but Mysteries struck me as the only one that reached into the truth of the place with the poetic heart of a Frenchman and the spirit of a truly initiated mystic. Mazier wrote of being allowed inside one of the sacred caves of the lost race, the Long Ears. I quote from the book, "The objects we were going to see were only the outer expression of things of spirit. The spirit gave them this significance and charged them with power. Let me explain. Whatever the religion or form of thought, even the most erotic, any object that has been submitted to human vows, actions, or desires remains charged with psychic that can, as we know, be transmitted and that are capable of giving out rays. Any object, that is, except those that have been made out of substances that have been essentially transformed. Symbols possess a frightening power of vital activation that the men of the island have never forgotten." End of quotes. The author then highlights some peculiarities concerning the items in the caves. And again, we are quoting from Mr. Mazier. "According to the natives, some of these things kept in the caves were not made by their ancestors, that is to say, not by the Polynesians. For the natives, these objects are still a block, a source of deep concern that the Catholic religion has been unable to exorcise from the island. All the sculpture is anthropomorphic. This osmosis between man and the primordial animals gives a glimpse of a strange knowledge, one that is not Polynesian." This is the end of quotes for the moment. because I wish to comment here that, of course, lion-headed humans are anthropomorphic. To return to Mazir's book, everything is like this. There were birdmen, whalemen, and lizardmen who were curiously like crocodile men. All these exactly formed shapes, carved with the highest artistic skill, are in a waiting and meditating posture. Here, this art in its precision becomes surrealistic and not magic. It is an art that has taken on flesh. Mazir speculates that, and again quotes, we cannot dismiss the possibility of some extraterrestrial contact suddenly irradiating the island. End of quotes. He comes to the conclusion that much of the anguish seen in some of the very specifically styled art, deformities of the human body, could have been produced by a radioactive force in the past. Thoth tells me that this is true, but comes from a later period than the Zumir code light occurrence. At some point in time, after the turmoil phase of the island, when the power of mana was abused, the sacred was abandoned. Mazir is aware of this desolation, as he writes, and I quote again, I am all the more uneasy because the natives say that everything died on Rapa Nui when mana left it. While at the same time, I see the amazing evidence of a quite extraordinary past. It may be that parapsychology will find a sympathetic vibration in this island with its perturbed, confusing magnetism. At this point, I recall something else a native told me. He said that the statues moved standing upright, making half turns on their round bases. This really does give the impression of an electromagnetic mechanism at work in a restricted field. Unquote. Another observation of Mazur is, and I quote again, very soon the night fell over this enormous beauty of violet lava, and very soon too we had to get back to our hut. At full gallop the horses raced along the faint track over the lava. Sometimes it echoed beneath their hooves, frightening them, and then again muffled the sound once more. This sudden hollow resonance from a vault or tunnel makes a most uncommon, violent impression. Here the network of caves work its way under the ground like the arteries in living flesh, and sometimes the crust lava is no more than a yard or two thick. End of quotes. And so now in 2024, I read all of this, and I connect it to so much more. It seems like something, you know, exotic, way far away land, all of that. But it is not, believe me. It is part of our experience now, because this is a major node on the planet. And it is part of our motherland, Mu, and the, you might say, fall from grace that we experienced, I say we as humanity, as we moved through the currents of Mu, out of the lotus reality into the physical reality, into the Muruvian continent. It's easier to say Lemurian, but actually Thoth says the name is Mu. And we move through all of that into our present cognizant state. And when you remove the aspect of linear time, we are still there, and we are going through this process. And also, we have arrived far beyond the state that we are in now into the new Earth Star. So if you take it as a whole vision from Alpha to Omega, and then you transport that into infinity, I know this is a big leap, you have a toroidal curve that takes us in and out, in and out, in and out of the whole process of spiritual integration in life. And yet, we're not just spinning our wheels. Every time there's a movement of the torus, it takes us to a greater beyond. This is the return through the homeward light. I have links to important relevant videos in the information box below. I would be interested in your comments as well. Thank you.